Hi, I'm Amy Baudette from the altE store. Thank you for watching our video series. We've broken it down into multiple parts to keep it manageable. This video is called Solar Electric Components, Overcurrent Protection. If you missed our earlier videos, I recommend you go back and watch the previous ones in the series to get a good foundation. We've gone over some of the main components in a solar electric system. Now let's talk about some of the less glamorous devices, the ones that make everything work together smoothly. In this video, we'll cover breakers and fuses and some of the enclosures they go into. Let's start with overcurrent protection, or OCP. One of the most important components in a solar system is the overcurrent protection, the fuses and the breakers. The key to a safely installed system is to plan for the unexpected and have the system automatically turn itself off if something goes wrong. A fuse or breaker is required on every segment of the system, protecting the wire between devices. A breaker has several advantages over a fuse. The breaker can also be used as a disconnect to turn off that segment. A fuse cannot be inserted or removed under load, so you need a way to turn off the current before removing or installing a fuse. And as you know, a fuse is a one-time use device. Once it blows, you need to replace it, whereas a breaker can just be reset once the problem has been resolved. However, fuses are usually less expensive than breakers and generally available in higher voltage ranges, which make them common in grid-tied systems. But remember, the fuse also needs a fuse holder, which can add to the expense. In this battery-based system, you see the DC breakers in the combiner box where multiple strings are being wired in parallel, the breakers at the input and output of the charge controller, and at the input of the inverter. There are also the AC breakers at the AC input and output of the inverter and the generator if used. When selecting the breakers or fuses for your system, in addition to selecting the right amps, be sure to select the maximum voltage they are rated for, and if they are for AC, DC, or both. Most DC breakers are rated for up to 150 volt DC, so grid-tied systems that have DC input up to 600 volts or even 1000 volts DC need to use fuses or specialty high voltage breakers. The National Electric Code requires you oversize any OCP by 25% if it will be running for more than 3 hours, which your solar system will. Also, the breakers before the charge controller need to be oversized an additional 25% for instances when the sun is shining brighter than the standard test condition, called over irradiance. So if your string is outputting 10 amps, you would need a breaker that can handle 15.6 amps, so probably round up to a 20 amp breaker. A ground fault is when there is current flowing through the grounding wire of a system, which is a bad thing. This is usually the result of a positive wire accidentally shorting with a grounded component. This is commonly caused during installation, when pulling the wire through the conduit and accidentally scraping off the insulation, causing the positive wire to touch a grounded metal conduit. Believe it or not, another common cause can be from squirrels chewing on the delicious insulation on the wires on the back of the panels, causing the positive wire to touch the grounded frame or racking. The National Electric Code requires that any PV system, with two exceptions, is required to have ground fault protection device, or GFPD. The two exceptions are both off-grid instances when their chances of fire are low. First, a ground or pole-mounted system that is isolated from any building and has up to two parallel strings, for instance, a standalone water pumping system. Second, for installs for non-dwellings, where nobody lives, where the grounding wire is doubled in size to handle any extra current. So as you can see, most installs require GFP. The good news is that all grid-tied inverters and some MPPT charge controllers, such as Midnight's Classic and Schneider's XW, have GFP built in. So you only need to have a separate GFP device if you are using a PWM charge controller or an MPPT that doesn't have it built in, like Outbacks or Blue Skies. Check your charge controller manual to determine if a GFP device is needed. Note that if you have a charge controller that has it built in, when you are using multiple charge controllers in your system, you need to disable all but one of them. Only one GFP can be used per system. Check the manual on how to disable the GFP on your device. The GFP works by having multiple breakers combined. One is between ground and negative, and the other is in the positive line of the circuit. If you have more than a half an amp detected between negative and ground, the small breaker trips and also trips the larger breaker that's on the positive line. If you have multiple devices in the system that require GFP, for instance, if you have two charge controllers that do not have GFP integrated, you would use a dual GFP that has one ground and negative connection, but multiple positive connections, one for each charge controller. Now let's go over the different breaker boxes commonly used in a PV system. The combiner box is generally installed outside near the solar panels. They provide a way to bring each string to its own breaker or fuse and then combine the outputs of the strings in parallel. You can then exit the combiner box with wire in conduit, protecting the wire as it travels back to inside the building to the grid-tied inverter or charge controller. An additional feature is available that allows you to throw a switch at the array, turning off the DC power coming out of the panels. Also, some have the ability to have a remote switch that is installed at the service entry point of the building, allowing firefighters to turn off the power from the array at the same location they are turning off the grid power to the house. States enforcing NEC's 2014's rapid shutdown are requiring this capability to protect firefighters. A combiner box is also a nice place to put a lightning arrestor, as it is generally at the location of the system that would be most susceptible to lightning strikes. The DC load center is generally installed in a battery-based system inside near the batteries, charge controller, and inverter. There are several different models available from different manufacturers, but they all usually contain the breakers from the PV array, the GFPD if needed, the breakers between the charge controller and battery bank, and the big breaker between the inverter and the battery bank. The AC load center provides a place to put your AC breakers in a battery-based system. You can't just have your mains breaker box for the output of a battery-based inverter, as anything in the mains box will be shut off when the grid is down. Having a separate AC breaker box allows you to isolate the AC output and power your critical AC loads from the batteries through your inverter. It also provides a location to wire in an optional generator if it is needed to supplement your solar when there's not enough sunshine. Bypass breakers allow you to remove the inverter from your system and power your loads from an alternate AC source, like the grid or a generator. This is useful if you need to take the inverter out for maintenance. If you're doing a straight grid-tied system, a separate AC breaker box is usually not needed. You would just add a two-pole AC breaker for the inverter output to your mains breaker box. To determine the size of the breaker, divide the wattage output of the inverter by the AC voltage, generally 240 volts in North America, and multiply it by 1.25 to oversize it by 25% as required by NEC. For instance, a 5,000 watt 240 volt inverter would need at least a 26 amp breaker, so you'd usually round it up to 30 amps AC breaker. A critical loads panel is used in a grid-tied battery backup system. It's just a regular AC breaker box that is separate from the mains breaker box. When the grid is up, the inverter is connected to both the mains box and the critical loads panel. Power is going to both. But when the grid goes out, the inverter disconnects from the mains box and only powers items wired to the critical loads panel, like your fridge and well pump, getting its power from the batteries. Items not considered critical, and therefore not connected to the critical loads panel, like your hot tub, will be off until the grid comes back. An ePanel, or power distribution panel, holds both the AC and DC breakers in one box. Makes for a clean install where all of the breakers are in one place, and some of the sections may be pre-wired from the manufacturer, saving time during the install. It's usually one ePanel per inverter. A battery-based inverter power panel is a pre-wired system complete with the inverter, charge controller, and breaker boxes with all the required breakers installed. They make installing the system a snap. Just hang it on the wall and connect it to the solar input, battery bank, and AC input and output. Hopefully this helped clear up some of the different overcurrent protection requirements and enclosures. Check out our website for a great selection of breakers and load centers, as well as most of the other balance of system equipment needed to install your solar system. Also watch more of our video series on our website. We've got a team of highly trained technical sales reps available to help you plan your system. Give us a call. And don't forget to check out the rest of our site at altestore.com, where we are making renewable doable.